Welcome to Wired AF. You're joined by your hosts, Steph and Brandon. Today, we're going to be talking about fitness watches. So Brandon and I both have a fitness watch. You have a Garmin Forerunner 735.
Yeah.
Is that the one?
Yeah, XT.
Yeah, XT. And I have a Fitbit Versa 2. I've had mine for under a year, probably like only 8 months or something. How long have you had yours?
This was a gift when I turned 21. So this is about 4 years old.
Yeah, so it's going pretty well.
Sponsored. This is a sponsored episode.
It's not sponsored. Cut that bit out, Brandon.
Sorry.
So anyway, we've been wearing our fitness watches for the last 2 weeks and we just wanted to do a bit of a chat about them and things we liked, what we think actually works with them, and then also what they're actually, like, do they actually work and the accuracy and all those kinds of things.
So I think we have two different people here, me and you. So obviously we're two different people, but as in, I don't normally wear a watch.
Yeah.
And you do. So yeah. You're someone who always, you brought one for you to personally use it.
Yes.
You were using this for a bit.
I was using that one,
so you could count the seconds in Pilates.
Yeah, exactly.
That was its purpose, not to count steps or do anything fancy like that. So you can see kind of our background, where we're coming from. I don't use a watch. It doesn't do anything special for me, but we're going to share our experiences. And there's plenty of our members use them. Plenty of people have the Whoop one now, which is becoming quite popular and also very expensive. And so we can just talk about, you know, how do they work? Do they actually do the things that they're setting out to do?
Yeah. So mine, unfortunately, had a little malfunction. It had a meltdown. I was wearing it for a week. So I've definitely got a week's worth of data, but then it broke. So the screen's not working. So I can't actually see anything on the screen, but I have all of the data on the phone. So that's, I don't know what's going on with it, but the screen's not working on mine. So I only have a week's worth of data and you have 2 weeks.
Yes, I do.
Yeah. So Brandon, I guess, first of all, what do you like about your Garmin, or what was your experience wearing yours?
I like the battery life. That's probably something that I can say is really good. So something that's probably a lot of people can relate to is having to charge them and then forgetting that you actually own them. And what we've seen a lot of is people use their Apple Watch for everything, and the Apple Watch is just an extension of their phone, as if they have two phones. So I don't use it for calls, like seeing calls or seeing notifications or seeing texts like that. I was just using it pretty much just as a pedometer, just for steps.
Did you wear it while you were training as well?
No, I can't. No, I don't want to do that.
No.
I should have probably done that, but I don't do that.
That's okay.
I do know that when you do press the, if you do put in strength mode, there's like a strength mode, strength training, and you put it in that mode. What's it going to tell me? I have a coach. I know what I'm doing. What's it going to tell you?
So it tracks the amount of time that you've been working out for and the calories you burn and your heart rate during that workout. I know this because I've used your watch as well as mine.
Well, calories burnt's not going to help me lift, you know, heavier, is it?
No.
It's not going to help me.
It doesn't matter.
No, it's not going to help me recover. For a lot of people, it's not going to matter.
Yeah.
So it's really interesting. The Garmin, so when you do a workout in it and if you do a workout in it and you finish and you click save, it'll tell you your recovery time. So that was something that was interesting. And we'll talk more about that later and how that actually works and if that's actually a good thing and if you should even consider that.
What I like about yours as well is it has functions for intervals, like interval timers. And I was using your one last year during lockdown to time the workouts or the classes that I was doing. So I could just set an interval like 45 seconds on, 15 seconds break. And then while I was teaching over the camera, the watch would just buzz and it would tell me the timer was up. So I loved that because I thought it was really easy to teach classes or group fitness like boot camps and stuff. Even Pilates classes having the seconds, like you said. For me, I really like your watch for that purpose. But again, training, like I don't think I used yours in training.
No, it's really good for, it's just a live stopwatch. I think that kind of Garmin watch is really useful for someone who's doing running or some kind of, you know, outdoor training where they need a GPS and they're doing something like that. And that's going to be really beneficial. But for someone like myself doing indoor stuff, when I'm jumping around and moving my arms, it's probably not going to be very accurate doing anything.
I've been using obviously my Fitbit, and like I quite like using my Fitbit, but I do find it kind of bulky in workouts. Like I don't actually like wearing it in workouts.
Do you wear it when you train?
I have been, Like, I mean, I prefer to not wear it when I train, but I do wear it when I train because I want to know my heart rate intervals and how my heart rate went up and down. But then we'll speak about it later. I don't know how accurate that is. I don't think it's that accurate because sometimes it says my heart rate's 120 and I know for a fact it's way higher because I'm dying and I can't breathe. So it's like, okay, that's probably not accurate. So yeah, but then I do like also, the calories don't really matter so much. But then in saying that, like I think some people might be driven by the calories burned in a workout. But again, I don't think that it really matters. Like I don't know, how do you gauge if you had a good workout or not by just the calories you burned?
That's like, how you gauge.
Did you lift heavier? Yeah. Like for me, I'm doing CrossFit training and like weightlifting stuff. It doesn't actually matter for me because it doesn't, just because I burned 200 calories doesn't really mean anything if I squatted 100 kilos. Like I'm happy with the squats and that calories burned. So I don't know. I don't think that mattered that much.
Yeah. We'll talk more about the metrics that you should be tracking, which is the purpose of this podcast. Yeah. But yeah, we'll get into that later.
Mine also has a sleep functionality. So you can wear it while you're sleeping and it tells you how much sleep you get each night and if you have good quality sleep. And I don't think it was very accurate with the sleep. Again, I only wore it a few times when I was sleeping because I found it really awkward and uncomfortable. And like, I actually didn't like wearing it while I was sleeping. And there's a little LED light on the back of them. And the flashing light like actually like kept me up. And I was like, oh, this is awful. So I didn't like that. But you know, sometimes it would tell me, I think the best quality sleep I got was like an 81 out of 100. And that was like 9 hours, like a really good sleep. And I felt refreshed and I thought I'd done well. But it was like, no, you've only had 81 out of 100 sleep. And I'm like, well, what the fuck? Like, I did a really good job. I thought I slept good. What do you mean I didn't have a perfect sleep yet? Yeah. So I was trying to get a perfect sleep score. Well, this is over the last few months anyway. And I never got a perfect sleep score on my Fitbit. So I don't know. I feel like I sleep good, but apparently the Fitbit doesn't think I do.
Yeah, try not to think about it too much. You and everybody else. Try not to let it keep you up at night. The and while we're on the LED light, it's really interesting because a lot of them have the LED light and we were just, you know, learning more about our watches and finding out that that's how the heart rate function is done. So those LED lights will shine, will go through your skin and then from there they'll determine, you know, very complicated. I'm not sure how accurate it is, and determine if your blood vessels are dilating or constricting, and then it will work on if there's blood flowing through that area in your wrist, and then determine your heart rate based on that. And you can imagine if you're moving your arm around and the watch moves as well, how accurate is your heart rate going to be?
Yeah. Well, I think you were telling me just before we started recording that if you were to wear a pedometer on your hip, that's more accurate than wearing a watch on your wrist because...
For steps, yeah. Yeah, because there's less movement happening, or that it's more accurate and more consistent movement happening at the hip than at the wrist when you're walking, if you're talking or carrying something or doing something like that. There's going to be a lot of variables, but where you just have it on your hip for the step count, it's going to be more accurate. So going back to heart rate, we want to have, you know, if you want to, what's the gold standard? Probably the heart rate strap on your chest, wearing a chest strap, and that's going to be a lot more accurate. But I can't imagine like trying to brace and like tense your back.
Like
and,
for lifting.
And wearing a heart rate strap. And imagine even some people who are, you know, quite muscly, I can't imagine that it being, you know, very comfortable to wear a heart rate strap while you're training. And imagine getting your arms overhead in a snatch. Yeah, well, there's no need. There's no need for it.
No, not in weightlifting anyways. Yeah. So did you find it helpful, like for steps? Did you take note of your steps?
Yeah, I did take note of my steps. Yeah. Lowest amount I got, which was 2,400. That was pretty...
On one day?
Yeah, I was pretty happy with that.
That's so low. What was mine?
I did nothing.
I'll check mine.
Yeah, I didn't... I struggled to... that was my Sunday, so I didn't do anything on that day and I just tried to be as immobile as I can. But the watch is really good, so... For someone, there has like a red activity meter on the side, and when that builds up, that means you've done nothing. And as you can see, it's a solid red right now, just because I haven't worn it this morning. But you can see that it tells you, you know, go move and it'll vibrate and whatever, and you're not being active. But I do think that, for me, it didn't do much for me. And you can see we've been looking up just before we started. There's been lots and lots of studies, lots of randomized control trials that show that. After 12 months of use, people are pretty much immune and they don't even realize they have an activity monitor on them, which is what these are. And people aren't really influenced by the watch on their wrist making them, you know, want to be more active. Yeah. You know, if it says, you know, I've had people you know, that do some nutrition stuff, and we'll nutrition coaching, and we'll monitor their activity levels, and it'll see that they're doing really low step count like myself. And, you know, that's one of the metrics that we want to try and increase, because of course being more active is going to be a good thing, and, you know, moving more is probably going to be really good for your health anyway. But as far as it motivating me, it didn't, probably didn't really do anything.
Well, for me, like, I mean, my lowest step count, there was a day I did 4,500, which is actually pretty low for me. And again, that was a Sunday, and that was a really miserable Sunday from memory as well. Like, it was just gross weather.
We'll just agree that that was the same day as mine.
Yeah, it did. That was the same day, I'm sure, because we would have hung out that day. I'm fairly certain, because we usually hang out Sundays sometimes.
Go on.
Anyways,
go on.
And then my biggest day of steps was 16,700, and that was on a Wednesday. And I know that on Wednesdays, I usually get lots of steps. Like, the Wednesday before that, I got 15,500, and I'm really busy on Wednesdays. So, like, I start work at 6 a.m. until 11. I usually go train at 12, and then I go back to work at about 4 or 5 until 9 p.m. So that's my big, big day of teaching. So I am on my feet literally all day. But that's not a normal for me. Like, my normal step count was probably about 8 or 9,000 on most days. And that's including workouts, when I would wear it during workouts as well. But then I'm not going to, because I'm already active at work and also in my workouts, my training, I wasn't really inclined to go for a walk to make up my steps, because I already knew I was moving in other ways. So, like, for me, it didn't motivate me either to get more steps in. In the past it has, but not right now.
So it's really interesting, because the main thing is, just because you're doing 20,000 steps or 15,000 steps or whatever at work doesn't mean that you've hit your activity target and you can go home, you can do nothing. There's a difference between being active at work and moving around between aisles and moving around and me walking around at the gym versus taking time out and actually doing a walk or doing some exercise dedicated to that time. So that's something that's really different, and that's something that, you know, just because you had a really high step count that day doesn't mean that you are going to get healthier or fitter from it, or you actually moved quite a lot. It could have just been you paced up and down the same, you know, 20 meter area for 12 hours.
Yeah.
Doesn't mean that you're going to be any healthier, or it doesn't mean it's going to affect your health anymore. A lot of people lack that time where they don't take time out to actually go and do a walk or something like that throughout the day. And that's something that needs to be said.
Yeah. I mean, like, you're definitely going to be healthier if you do, say, 10,000 steps compared to 2,000 steps, but, like, it's going to be better for you being more active in that sense. But I guess the point there is that you do need to actually make an effort for it to be like an actual activity, going to exercise, get your heart rate up when you're going for a walk, get some fresh air outside, or go and do a workout at the gym. Like, that's going to be more beneficial compared to just walking in the office up and down.
Yeah, because those steps could have been a shuffle in your office corner. Then that could have racked you up heaps. If the receptionist has to go and talk to you 15 times and it's a 10-step time every time, like up and back, doesn't mean she did a lot of steps, or he or she. It's irrelevant. You need to take time out to do exercise. So that was something that's really important.
So then I guess some of the main questions we've got. Oh, sorry. Random facts, first of all, from the Garmin Connect. You've written some notes here.
Yeah. So something that was really interesting with the Garmin is the Garmin Connect app is it also has, so where watches have obviously evolved and there has that whole app and software. So software is something that's pretty big with these kind of watches, and something that you're getting is you're not just getting a watch that you're wearing on your wrist, you're also getting the software. And that's one of the benefits of buying the Whoop app is you're getting that software. The watch actually comes free. It doesn't even have the time on it. So you're actually buying that software. With the Garmin Connect, you can log in when you brought pairs of shoes, and it'll tell you when you brought a bike, when you brought a shoe. There's like a gear section. But something that I thought was really good is people that have no idea about training, I looked at their training program. So it has heaps and heaps of training programs in there.
Yeah.
One's running, some intervals. If you wanted to build up to do a 5K or a 10K run, there were some workouts, like 6 to 8 week programs. And even longer, there was a 16-week program in there.
Mm-hmm.
So it was really interesting. And that's something that could be really useful for people who have those apps or have those watches but aren't using the full capability of those apps.
Yeah.
But of course, we'd always recommend you get a coach instead.
Yeah. Well, mine has like all of the smartwatch notifications. So mine's, you know, obviously newer than yours is. So yeah, my Fitbit has the, you can turn on the connectivity with your phone. So it connects via Bluetooth. So you can play Spotify through the watch. You can get messages, text messages, emails, calendar notifications, weather as well. You can get all of that on the Fitbit, and you can also get those notifications pretty much throughout the day, anytime. I ended up turning mine off because they were really annoying. I just didn't want to get notified constantly that, oh, you have a text, you have an email. And I'm like, another one, like, leave me alone. Like, I just want to do my thing. Like, so for me, I actually don't like that function. But you know, some people might like it.
Yeah. Each to their own.
Yeah.
Moving on.
The next one, I guess a main question we want to ask is, do they actually make you fit? Well, I guess we've already sort of touched on this. I don't think that they make you fitter.
Well, one of the key things when we talk about heart rate and the inaccuracy is if someone's doing heart rate training where they're trying to keep their heart rate within a certain threshold, and if your heart rate is going to be inaccurate by plus or minus 20 and you're using a wrist-based heart rate monitor like these watches and you're not using a chest strap, you can see how inaccurate it's going to be.
Yeah.
So from that perspective, obviously, not going to be a good choice. We said use the chest strap, use something like that. But yeah, the metrics that you should be tracking, and this is the most important part of this podcast, is you shouldn't be concerned about the amount of calories that you burnt from training. You shouldn't be concerned about your recovery time that was produced from your watch, because that's going to be measured on the amount of on your heart rate, especially from this Garmin, and that's how that calculates it. Your sleep is going to be much more important, and the time spent in bed is usually the gold standard. And that's, if you've listened to our podcast While We Sleep, the most important thing was time. They calculated sleep as time in bed rather than the amount of hours you slept, because obviously that there can be some, you know, variability in that. But those kind of metrics, sleep, nutrition, and your performance in the gym, you know, how was your technique? Are you progressing in the weights that you're doing? Could you do three extra sets on the weight that you did last week that you struggled with and you only could do one or two reps? Are you improving strength-wise? Can you do pull-ups? Are you closer to doing pull-ups? You know, things like that. There's a number of things that are so much more important, those skill-based movements. And that's where people get really caught up and, you know, people will screenshot, oh, massive workout, 600 calories burnt. And it's like, cool. I don't know if you're going to be, you know, if it was, you know, I don't know if you're going to be
what
any
does it
fitter.
Actually mean?
Yeah, especially yeah, it if it was really like a, yeah, yeah. Okay, I'm going to offend a lot of people, but no, yeah. So those are the metrics that I'm going to stop. Those are the metrics that you want to be looking for, and the performance-based ones are going to be so important. And that's where, you know, using a spreadsheet or, you know, writing down things, working with a coach, whether you have an online program or not, and you can measure those metrics. Those are the things that are going to be really important. And a lot of those changes won't occur until a lot later in time. So, you know, Garmin's thing is whatever, I think is better than yesterday. Nothing's going to change from yesterday. Things are going to...
It takes time.
Improvements, improvements in the gym and improvements in training have a really big latency, and they'll occur often like months down the track. It takes 3 to 6 months for you to peak up for a competition when you're already at a level in training. So it takes time for those changes that you've made to your, you know, training and whatnot to actually come through. So it's unlikely that, you know, tracking those kind of metrics are actually going to do anything for you.
Yeah. I think maybe like I can see that it might be applicable for someone who maybe does like who it might benefit. I'm trying to think of it with the watches. Someone who's an endurance athlete, like we sort of spoke about earlier, who does triathlons, Ironmans, lots of running, cycling, swimming, those kinds of things, because it helps you track your split times and things like that on the running.
Because you won't have your phone on you.
Yeah. And then another person would maybe be like someone who's quite sedentary, and they just need that reminder to get up and
motivation.
Move. And it's like they literally are not planning on going to the gym. They're not planning on doing anything extra, but having something on their watch that buzzes will actually get them up and moving. Maybe it's going to help them move a little bit more than what they otherwise would, but then, look, again, I don't think it will actually make you fitter. It'll just make you move a little bit more than what you would otherwise. It's a really good like starting point maybe for people, with just the step count, but we can do better. You can do better.
Yeah, you can do way better than that. Yeah, 100%. And especially considering the cost of these things.
Yeah.
That's something else to be considered altogether.
Well, something we were talking about, you know, like sometimes people buy a fitness watch because they want to track their steps and they want to get their 10,000 steps a day. But, you know, if you went for an hour walk, that's going to get you pretty close to 10,000 steps, probably like around the 8,000 mark, depending on how big your strides are. So if you consider that a 1 hour walk each day, it's probably an hour and 15 minutes will get you your 10,000. You could just do that and not spend the money on the watch if you wanted. Or I'm fairly certain there are free apps you can download on your phone that are pedometers, or you could even buy a pedometer instead of
a fitness watch. But your phone just tracks it automatically. Yeah.
Well, yeah. So like, you know, you don't have to go out and buy a watch to tell you how many steps you've done if that's your goal of the watch, essentially. I don't know.
Bit of a gimmick.
Yeah, I think it's a bit of it. Well, I guess the final question is, do we think that they're worth getting?
Well, that's the thing. They're, it's just like a fashion accessory at this point. But some of them even look like one of those, you know, when people are under house arrest and they've got those things on their ankles. What are they called? Those like the, you know what I'm talking about.
The bracelets. Yeah, like the jail bracelet they look like things.
I don't know if it's called a jail bracelet. My mind's gone blank now. Yeah, I'm sure one of our listeners is probably biting their tongue trying to say what it is and cringing. But yeah, it looks, some of them look like that. And yeah, I don't know. I think, yeah, like I said earlier, the most important thing is tracking metrics that you're actually going to see improvement in, and those are going to drive you to improve a lot more.
So I guess like that's our little chat today on fitness watches. I mean, I like mine. I'm going to keep wearing it because I need it for work with Pilates to sort of see the time when I'm teaching a class. But I wouldn't track it for my actual fitness, I don't think. It doesn't really affect me. How about you?
No, I'm going to go back to the spreadsheet and keep grinding away through my program. Yeah, this is going to probably go. You'll see a bunch of the, photos of the Garmin online. We'll be putting it on the Instagram page. It'll be used for that. But that's about it. It'll probably go back in the drawer.
Or maybe I'll use it since my Fitbit has now carked it. So can I borrow it again?
Yeah, you can. Thank you. I'll let you use it here. And if you guys haven't already seen, we've got our book club episode, Eat Like the Animals. We did it with the author. So that's going to be coming out next Thursday. So in a fortnight's time, it's going to be a really good episode. We spoke for about 55 minutes on the book. We went a little bit off tangent. There were so many things I could have spoken to him about as far as content inside the book. There were so many things that he wanted to add in at the end. And he even offered if it wasn't a good episode, he would want to do it again. And he would want to redo it. So he was really, really nice to work with. And hopefully it's not our last collaboration with David. And Steph couldn't be there on that day for the episode because she had her Pilates course, but that's okay. Next time, hopefully we can do it with the three of us, and I'm sure she'll have some questions that she'll want to ask him as well. So it'll be a great one. But yeah, that's something to look forward in the next week. We'll see you guys then.
Bye.